Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, good morning. One and all. Happy New Year.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, good morning and welcome to worship. We're so glad that you have joined us. It's good in these difficult days to be able to at least come together in this way. We can't meet together, but we can share an experience of worship together. We have been doing some stuff online this week. One of our cell groups has started up again, meeting on Wednesdays. And if you think, well, do you know what? I'd like to maybe try out what that feels like. We've got some material, 6 weeks of stuff. And if you'd like to just kind of see what it feels like to be part of an online group, we'd love to give you that opportunity. Just inbox me. As well, I just wanted to mention that on the 30th of January, Heidi is going to prepare a quiz for us. Online on Zoom, she's enlisted Katie to help her, so there's something else to watch out for a week on a Saturday. If you're not out doing anything, it might be a pleasant distraction. So a couple of other online things happened this week. It's been incredible that since the 22nd of March, every night there's been people gathering to pray. We'll never know the difference that's made and the strength and encouragement that has created for those who've been part of that. We'll never know really the way that God will use all those prayers, and it still goes on. So tonight is night 302. Really, really welcome to drop in. And Music Man, what a team the Music Man team are. They hit a landmark this week, didn't they?
Yeah. We've been going now for 40 weeks online, which is fantastic. So a big shout out to all our team and our students who come along and enjoy Thursday sessions together.
Yeah, well, this morning our service, we're thinking about Abraham and the occasion when God asks him to sacrifice Isaac, and this idea of covenant. We'll be dipping into that, but we've got some other stuff planned as well, haven't we?
Yeah, Bill Dolling and also Esther will be leading us in prayer, and we'll be finding out what the young people have been up to this past week. And again, we have some really powerful and very encouraging testimonies and words from members of our church family. So thank you very much for those.
Yeah, we start off with our first song, which talks about sometimes we're in a desert, sometimes we're in a place where everything's fantastic. So wherever you are, wherever it's at for you this morning, we just pray that we'll really meet with God as we worship. And our first song is Blessed Be Your Name.
Streams of abundance flow. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 to 24 says, "The Lord's love never ends. His mercies never stop. They are new every morning. Lord, your loyalty is great. I say to myself, the Lord is mine, so I hope in him." The writer of this book and those verses is ever so sad. Everything around him is going wrong, and he is bewildered and confused. Yet he holds on to those facts. And that's what I'm going to do this year. I'm going to hold on to this verse and the facts inside it, that the Lord's love never ends and his mercies never stop. They are new every morning, and I'm going to seek them and search them out every day.
Hello, I would like to share with you one of my daily devotionals entitled "Fix Your Eyes on Jesus," with reference to Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 32, about Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, walking on the water. "Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on a mountain by himself to pray. And when evening had come, he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, 'It is a ghost!' And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Be of good cheer, it is I. Do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.' So he said, 'Come.' And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, 'O you of little faith, why did you doubt?' And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased." When Peter stepped out of the boat at Jesus' instruction, he was doing something he had never done before. As long as he remained in faith by keeping his eyes on Jesus, he was successful. It wasn't until fear gripped his heart that he began to sink. Peter's mistake was that he became preoccupied with the storm. When he focused on the circumstances around him rather than the Saviour close to him, he lost his faith and began to doubt. Romans 4:18 to 21 tells us that Abraham did not waver in his faith when faced with difficult circumstances. He was aware of his situation, but instead of becoming preoccupied with it like Peter, he was determined to focus on God's ability and presence in the middle of his situation. We can learn from Peter's mistakes and Abraham's example. We can be aware of our circumstances without being preoccupied with them. We can purposely keep our eyes on Jesus, trusting in faith that he'll provide the miracle we need. When the storms come in your life, focus on Jesus. Stay determined to walk with him no matter how high the waves are, and know that he's always with you, no matter how strong the storm.
Happy New Year, everybody. Wow, as we enter into 2021, my anchor for this year is "The battle belongs to the Lord." And this is derived from the second book of Chronicles, chapter 20, where we know that when we enter into the place of praise, the Lord takes over. So even though if looks as though there is a mess around us, the Lord, when he takes over our battles, our messes turn into a greatest messages in our lives. So I just encourage everybody this year to lift their eyes unto the Lord, who is the maker of heaven and earth. Paul says that we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against the powers and principalities. And we know that God is only the one who can fight their battles for such. So this year, we just have to tell ourselves that the battle belongs to the Lord. And get ready to collect your spoils, for the Lord will have taken over. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Hi everyone, happy new year to you all. I know it's a very difficult season for all of us, but one passage in the Bible that the Lord used to encourage me is Psalm 121 verse 7 that says, I will preserve you, I will preserve your soul. I'm saying that to myself, the Lord will preserve me, the Lord will preserve my soul. I want you to say that to yourself too. Do you know what? God has made a promise to us. So all we need to do is just to hold tight on Him, to fix our eyes on the cross. Never take your eyes away from the cross. No matter how difficult it is, no matter what you're going through, hold on to God. He is working for you. He is fixing things for you. I want you to know that what God cannot do does not exist. Fix your eyes on Him. He will take care of you. He will preserve you. He will shield you. He will protect you in the name of Jesus. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. COVID-19 has made a big impact on all of us, and probably it has dominated our lives in 2020. It brought us pain and suffering. I myself have experienced anxiety reactions, especially during the early months of lockdown. But I realized during that time, I can go beyond my fears, and I need to trust and keep my faith alive and not be afraid that God is in control in all of this. I believe I was able to manage pretty well and grateful for the many things that has kept my faith and trust alive, including our church family and Michael's support. My work, of which I am truly grateful for, have also kept me sane and helped me keep going. In the last few months of 2020, it was clear that COVID will continue to cause pain and suffering to us. It was like, here we go again. Is there an end to it? 2021 is just another 2020. Where is this light at the end of the tunnel that people keep saying? Ahead, we can see a gloomy picture of 2021. I can't help but ask myself, anxiety, are you coming back in my life? However, in one of my quiet moments in the last few days of 2020, I was drawn particularly to Psalm 18, especially the first two verses. I could sense that these words would become another security blanket for 2021. Since then, I added these verses in my daily prayer. It was like a comforting and reassuring message to me for my life amidst COVID in 2021 of God's unfailing love. He is my rock and my savior, in whom I find protection. I like very much the first statement of verse 1, which says, I love you, Lord. I find this is so important to me that I could express my love to God, my God who loves me unconditionally. So here is it, Psalm 18. I love you, Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my savior. My God is my rock, in whom I find protection. He is my shield, the power that saves me, and the place of safety. Thank you, everyone. May God bless us all. Bye.
Dear God, thank you for all the children and young people in our church, and for all those who encourage us, look after us, and help us. Thank you that even when our schools are closed, we can still learn at home. We thank you for all the teachers working so hard in schools and teaching remotely and online, and for all the staff working in education who are under a lot of stress. We also thank you for our parents who are trying to help us learn at home. Thank you that we can do our schoolwork. we can enjoy exercising indoors. And outdoors. We can relax. We can cook. We can play and have fun. And we can enjoy music. We can be creative and make things. We can use technology to keep connected. And we can do our best to stay safe and keep others safe. We pray for all those who are ill. Please come close to them and help them get better. Be with all doctors, nurses, and other critical workers and give them help and strength. Thank you for all the vaccines which are being given to give protection against the virus. Thank you that you care about each one of us and for everyone we love. Please be with us all, protect us, and keep everyone safe. Amen.
Good morning. I've been asked to share with you a prayer that I prayed about 3 years ago, and I shared it on Facebook, which isn't something I typically do, but someone reshared it this week, and it seemed to be relevant and timely for today. So I've been asked to share it with you. So my prayer is that as you hear the words, you'll just reflect upon them and allow them to minister to you. As the blanket of night is slowly drawn back and the light of day that has never been lived before fades seamlessly in, I pray for those who will struggle silently for meaning and reasons to even keep going today. For those who will smile in the workplace and just function as normal whilst breaking up and crying on the inside. For those for whom today will be so different from yesterday. Through circumstances out of their control. I pray also for those for whom today, by stark contrast, will seem no different from any other day. For those that mourn and grieve, I pray comfort. For those consumed with regret, worry, and doubt, I pray peace. For those that hurt, healing and forgiveness. As for me right now, I'm just thankful for the gift of life and a brand new day, a fresh canvas and an opportunity for each of us to bring light or shade into the lives of those we encounter, whether motivated by faith or feelings, by measured goodwill or just an extravagant overflow of what's going on the inside. It's a choice. Friends, we can choose to bring light or shade, a sweet smell, a fragrance, or a stench to those that we meet and communicate with. But for those upon whom the light has come, a gentle reminder, it's not an optional extra, it's a given. You are the light of the world, Jesus said. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. God bless you.
Good morning, Leslie. Thank you so much for joining us and for sharing your thoughts with us. Would you like to share with us how you spend time regularly with God?
Okay, well, I have a regular quiet time first thing in the morning. And since I'm retired, I tend to sleep in rather late. So I don't normally get up till about half past eight. So I usually just get dressed, but I get back into bed because it's the warmest place in my house at the moment. And then I have about an hour's quiet time. So I have a bit of a routine at the moment, which I'm enjoying. So Psalm 50, verse 23 says, "He who sacrifices thank offerings honours me." So I've written down a selection of praise verses that I can offer each morning to start my quiet time off with. So firstly, I would invite the Father, Son and Holy Spirit to come and be with me and to cleanse me and fill me with himself. And then I would pray out loud my praise verses, which is a great way to start the day. And then I've started using an old hymn book that I was given when I was baptized in 1967. And I just, although they're old fashioned words, they're just very devotional. And I find it really helps me to just appreciate, you know, the real sacrifice of God's Son for us. And it just helps me and leads me into prayer. And then I would use the UCB word for the day, which I find God often speaks to me through. And then I'll read my NIV Bible, usually a chapter from the new and a chapter from the old. And I'll have a little notebook and write down anything I think God is teaching me or saying to me. And I'll also keep a record of any answers to prayer so that I can look back on and be encouraged about. And then after a bit of reflection on what I've read, I'll ask God to just make me a blessing through my day. So that usually takes about 3/4 of an hour to an hour.
Wow.
Which is lovely. So it's really good.
And do you ever struggle, Leslie?
I think the only time I struggle, Louise, is when I put too much into my day and I don't give God that first slot, because then I just find it a struggle to get that time in, which I shouldn't really. But so I always try and make it first thing, give God the first bit of my day.
Yeah.
Do
you ever use music or anything as well?
On the odd occasion, I'll put on a song, but I don't normally do it in my quiet time. I would normally listen to Christian music, perhaps in the car.
And how long have you been doing this for, Leslie?
Well, I think because I became a Christian through the Brethren, and they were really strong at, you know, getting you into doing, making good habits.
Yeah.
And so it's just been a daily habit that I can't say I've kept up every day for all of my life, seeing I'm quite old. But, you know, it's an ingrained habit, but it's a good one. And practice doesn't make perfect, but practice makes it permanent. And I just think it's a really good thing to have inbuilt in your day.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much. Why, you've probably answered the question actually just now. I was going to say, why is it important to you to have time with God? Is there anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I wrote a little bit down. It's absolutely important because the Bible is God's living word to us. And, you know, we know that all scripture is God breathed and the word of God is living and active. And it just does so much for us. You know, the word feeds us, it encourages us, it builds us up, it inspires us, it guides us, it challenges us, it strengthens us, and so much more. So, yeah, we need to, you know, have God's word read. Yeah.
And what would you say to encourage anyone who's struggling with having time with God on a regular basis?
I would say, you know, forget the past, start afresh, you know, just try every day to just give them at least 5 minutes, 10 minutes even. Put your phone somewhere else so you're not distracted. Just sit with God, you know, right back at the beginning, you know, God came and walked and talked with Adam and Eve. He wants that relationship with us. So it is really important. Get yourself a notebook and just sit and give it a go. Just start afresh. If you fail, pick yourself up, start again. You know, it's worth pursuing.
That's such good advice. Thank you so much. Would you like to share a prayer with us, Leslie?
Okay. Yeah. Father, we just thank you for your precious word. We thank you that you want each one of us to spend time with you. And yeah, Lord, we just pray that you would put that desire within our hearts to spend that time with you, to make time for you, Lord. You know, you have given us so much, Lord. Just help us to give you that time and to just grow in our relationship with you day by day, Lord. That's what you want, a relationship. How amazing is that, Lord? Thank you very much. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Leslie. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Oh, Abraham. Whenever I think of the story of Abraham and Isaac on the mountainside, I'm full of huge emotions. One is awe that Abraham and God had such an intimate and trusting relationship, and that Abraham trusted God absolutely, completely. And the other emotion is that I just want to go and run away and hide when I remember what God called Abraham to do. And I think of my own family and just think of that enormous trust that Abraham had in God. And I worry, would God actually challenge me in such a way? Would he place something so enormous on my heart? Now, through my lifetime, there have been some challenges, and there are two examples where God encouraged me. He put in front of me in writing things that he wanted me to do, and both of those were apply for different jobs. One of those jobs was to go and work in Romania in the orphanages, and the other one was to go and work amongst other Christians. And both of them, I didn't feel I had the skills or the right experience to go and do. And in both of those, I trusted that if God wanted me to go, then I would get the jobs. And I did. I got both of the jobs. And I feel very strongly that God wanted to send me to those places to refine me. He had a plan. And as part of that plan, he was there with me. And each of those jobs had challenges. And I definitely grew and changed through both of those experiences. Now, today I was reading Psalm 11. Verse 5, and it says, "The Lord tests the righteous and the wicked. If we do not have our faith and relationship with God, then we would be undone. We place our trust in God, who provides our hope." And I think that reminds me that our challenges don't need to be that we're called to sacrifice one of our children on a mountaintop. We need to trust daily in what God is asking us to do and turn to him through for his support and his love through all those experiences.
Morning, everybody. When I think about being in a covenant with God, since I first became a Christian, there's been lots of times when I've had to trust and rely on him completely. Probably far too many to mention. But I can remember one time when I was absolutely at my wit's end and not knowing what to do or where to turn. And I looked up into the sky and there was not one rainbow, but two. And they were absolutely beautiful, the most vivid rainbows I've ever seen before. And I just felt like it was God saying to me, you know, I've promised you that I am in control and I will never let you down. We are in that covenant together, and just trust me as much as you can with all your power and your might. And shortly after that, things did sort through, and praise God. Things did turn out for the best. Another time I was asked by God to do a fasting and prayer once a week in the most unusual place. And well, not so much an unusual place, right in the centre of Hedge End, so that's not really unusual. But what he asked me to do was walk in the shape of the cross, and to remind myself exactly what he'd done for us on the cross. And again, to never forget what he did on that cross for us. He sacrificed absolutely everything, and he would have done that if I was the last person on the earth. So again, to remind me that who's in control, who has the victory, when I really felt like I was in a complete desert, just dry. And again, things quickly sorted out. And shortly after that, I was able to praise God and give him thanks for another massive answer to prayer. And I think when you look back at those times when he doesn't let you down, it gives us great strength and courage to face the things that we're either going through or we will be going through. So yeah, I would just encourage everybody to look to God in this particular time when things are really uncertain and we don't know the way forward. To just take heart and know that God is in that covenant with us and he will never let us down.
has been known for parents to deceive their children. When you hear the ice cream van music, it means they've run out of ice cream. I heard of one dad who convinced his five-year-old that his middle name was Danger. It must be true because it's on Twitter. And so when his boy went to school, he told everyone in the class that his dad's name was James Danger Breakwell. I heard of one mother who convinced her daughter that hummus was a princess food. There's all kinds of stories about this kind of stuff. One of my favourites is about the dad who told his son that he only got 10,000 words a month. And if his son was getting too chatty, he would say to him, "You're up to 9,000, you've only got 1,000 left, use them carefully." I did hear as well about a little girl who wanted a dog. And the mother said, "Well, what we'll do is we'll put a stone in the garden and we'll water the stone every day. And when the stone stops growing, then you can have a dog." And so to the girl's amazement, the stone kept growing and growing and growing until she gave up. It was years later that she discovered that every day when she went to school, her mum would switch the stone over. Surname wasn't Dedenham, as far as I know. I once deceived my children on a holiday about Wi-Fi use. We'd been to the same place for 4 or 5 years, lovely place in the middle of the country, and we arrived to find they'd put in Wi-Fi. And I worked out which fuse it was on, and I told the kids that the good news was that there was internet, but the bad news was that it only worked between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. Because of the remote location. And so I used to flick the internet on and off in an effort to keep them off their devices and more interactive. I've got to confess, I am involved in a deception with one of my children that has lasted 3 years so far and does involve a member of our congregation, but we'll leave that one well alone. We're going to look at the story of Abraham and Isaac today. And I kind of wonder whether God is involved in some kind of a deception, because I don't believe for one second that he ever intended Isaac to die. We're going to have a look at our cartoon, narrated by David Suchet, our animation, just now. So hear the story afresh. Try and listen to it as if you'd never heard it before, and let it shock you. Let it surprise you once again.
The present. God knew that his secret rescue plan could only work if Abraham trusted him completely. God had to make sure Abraham would do whatever he asked. So a few years later, God asked Abraham to give him a present. Now, Abraham liked giving presents to God. He gave God his animals. They were called sacrifices, and they were a way to say, "I love you," to God. But this time, God didn't want a lamb or a goat. God wanted Abraham to give him something more, much more. He wanted Abraham to give him his son, his only son, the son he loved, Isaac. Put this boy on the altar and kill him as the sacrifice? How could God want him to do such a terrible thing? Abraham didn't understand. But he knew that God was his father who loved him, and so Abraham trusted him. Early the next morning, Abraham and Isaac set off. They climbed the steep, stony trail up the mountain. Isaac carried the wood on his back. His father carried the knife and the coals. "Papa," Isaac said, "we have everything except we forgot the lamb for the sacrifice." "God will give us the lamb, son," Abraham said. They built an altar and laid the wood on top. Abraham asked his son to climb on top of the wood. Isaac didn't understand, but he knew his father loved him, and so he trusted him. He climbed up onto the altar, and Abraham tied his boy to the wood. Isaac didn't struggle or try to run away. He just lay there quietly and didn't make a sound. Everything was ready. Abraham took the knife Tears were filling up his eyes. Pain was filling up his heart. His hand was shaking. He lifted the knife high into the air. Stop! God said. Don't hurt the boy. I want him to live and not die. I know now that you love me because you would have given me your only son. Well, Abraham felt his heart leap with joy. He unbound Isaac and folded him in his arms. Great sobs shook the old man's whole body. Scalding tears filled his eyes. For a long time, they stayed there like that, in each other's arms. The boy and his dad. Suddenly, Abraham saw a ram caught in some brambles. The sacrifice! God had given them what they needed just in time. The ram would die so Isaac didn't have to. And so Abraham sacrificed the ram instead of his son. And as they sat there on the mountaintop, watching the embers of the fire die in the cool night air, the stars above them sparkling in the velvet sky, God helped Abraham and Isaac understand something. God wanted his people to live, not die. God wanted to rescue his people, not punish them. But they must trust him. One day, someone will be born into your family, God promised them, and he will bring happiness to the whole world. God was getting ready to give the whole world a wonderful present. It would be God's way to tell his people, I love you. Many years later, another son would climb another hill, carrying wood on his back. Like Isaac, he would trust his father and do what his father asked. He wouldn't struggle or run away. Who was he? God's son. His only son. The son he loved. The Lamb of God.
And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. These words are found in Paul's letter to the church at Rome in chapter 8, and I found myself saying this to somebody this week. It's easy to believe that God works all things together for good when most things are working together for good. I mean, it's true that it takes faith to hold on to that concept when things are not so good. I mean, take Joseph, who endured some very mixed fortunes during his life, and having risen to a place of prominence in Egypt, he says to the brothers who sold him into slavery, look, God has turned into good what you intended for evil. Now, one of the reasons the Bible is so important to us, one of the reasons that we need to pay attention to it, is because the events, the stories, the teaching from then can inform our today. If you're watching this, it means you're alive. And if you're alive, that means your story isn't done. And if your story isn't done, then God might want to speak. And when God speaks, God is good. That said, we're turning today to quite a challenging narrative from the Bible, from Genesis. Still thinking about covenant. God had made a covenant with Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Abraham is called to leave Haran to set out for a place that God will show him. And there's three bits to the promise that God makes. The promise of land, the promise of descendants, and the promise of blessing for Abraham and all who will follow, all those descendants who will outnumber the stars in the sky. But there's a problem. Abraham and Sarah can't bear children. In chapter 17, we read that there's a name change. Abram, which means exalted father, is dropped. And Abraham is bestowed, is introduced, meaning father of many. Abraham is 100, yes, 100, and Sarah is a sprightly 90. And yet this couple who have never born children, a year later, have a son, in line with what God says, called Isaac, meaning he laughs. I'm not sure who was laughing most, God or Abraham. And God promises this and delivers it where it seems impossible. And Project Father of Many is on. It's go. There's a bloodline from Abraham and Sarah through a son called Isaac, which is absolutely brilliant. Except in chapter 22, verses 1 and 2, we read this. Later on, God tested Abraham's faith and obedience. Abraham, God called. Yes, he replied. Here I am. Take your son, your only son. Yes, Isaac, who you love so much, and go to the land of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I will point out to you. I have to say, when I watched today's movie, I really balked at it. I found it horrible. This child, this only son, loved so much. God says, please, could you slaughter him? Now, if you need something to celebrate, child sacrifice is no longer a norm, but to Abraham it wasn't an alien idea. The idea of sacrificing to gods with a small g was not an uncommon practice. Really, it was to do with the weather, because if the weather conditions are right, the crops grow, and if the crops grow, there's no famine, and if there's no famine, people live. So you keep the gods on your side by sacrificing. But as soon as a culture sets out on this sacrifice to keep the gods happy trajectory, and the crops fail, and you have to express greater devotion and sacrifice more and more and more, Where does it lead? Well, it led to the sacrifice of children. I mean, that these things were common practice. It's reprehensible. And suddenly 2021 feels a whole lot more civilized. But then God's always been about moving humanities and societies forward into better ways of living. The real trouble with the Abraham Isaac story for me is that I've heard it presented so often with a guilt-inducing agenda. Preachers lecturing, look at Abraham, look at what he was willing to sacrifice. What will you give? Could you do what he did? Are there limits to your devotion? And then I became a parent, and it's like, frankly, yes, there are. And rightly so. So we approach this story today a bit differently, by looking at Abraham's trust in the goodness of God. Because this story is not primarily about will Abraham be willing to murder his own son or not. I would suggest that Abraham, whilst it all must have felt very strange and quite uncomfortable, did not believe for one second that his son would be harmed. That might be a new idea for you, but this is primarily why I say this thing. In chapter 22, in verse 3, Abraham gets up, early start, saddles the donkey, chops some wood, sets out with Isaac and his two servants. On the third day of the journey, they arrive, and Abraham parks the donkey, and he tells the servants to look after it. And he says, me and Isaac, we're heading on a bit further. We're going to head up the mountain, we're going to worship, and then we will come straight back. We will come straight back. We? Yep, Abraham and Isaac. And on the way up the hill, Isaac almost naively asks, hold on a minute, we've got the wood and the fire, but where's the lamb? I wonder if he was feeling a bit nervous. Abraham said to him, don't worry, my son, God will provide the sacrifice. And the drama continues, and it must have been pretty frightening for both parties, a father and son, Isaac bound on top of a pile of wood on an altar, Abraham with the knife drawn. You know those films that go down to the wire, only 2 seconds left and Tom Cruise deactivates the nuclear device. It's a matter of seconds before the rope snaps and Indiana Jones falls to his death with the crocodiles. I wonder what was going on in Abraham's heart and mind when the angel finally appeared at the last minute and said, Abraham, Abraham, put the knife down. And we all know at the movies that Tom Cruise is going to save the world. But did Abraham feel that tension? Was Abraham, like talking to God later, did he say, God, you took that right to the edge, didn't you? Real drama. I think Abraham meant it when he said to his servants, we will be back in a moment. I think he meant it when he said to Isaac, fret not, lad, God will provide the ram. I really believe he did, because God had established a good track record of delivering on his promises. God was never going to let Isaac be harmed, and I think Abraham knew that deep in his heart. And then God did provide the sacrifice, and Abraham was no doubt relieved, but not surprised. So in summary, Abraham and God have a track record. God had revealed himself many times to this man of faith. He'd proved himself to Abraham. Abraham had come to understand the character of good. Abraham is described as a man who was righteous because of his faith. He trusted God. He believed God. But it was because what God had done for him as well. He'd been walking with God for 25 years plus the age of Isaac. I don't know how, it doesn't say how old Isaac was. Let's say Isaac was 10. Abraham had been walking with God for 35 years. Abraham obeyed God's unexpected command concerning his son because I think he believed God's promises about descendants that outnumbered the stars. And he knew God was good and trustworthy. God was, still is those things, completely good, utterly trustworthy. And we know that sometimes we have to dig deep and we have to look over our shoulder at what we've learned to be true of the way that God has helped us through in the past. God is good. Life isn't always easy, but God is essentially, in essence, he is goodness. Does life always make sense? No. Is God always good? Yeah, he is. Secondly, Abraham clearly did not think Isaac would die. We'll be back, he said to his servants. God will provide the ram, he says to Isaac. It seems that Abraham was prepared to do what God asked, but he expected a completely different outcome, and that's what happened. And we can read this story in all kinds of ways, but our horror and revulsion that we might feel at what could have happened must be eclipsed by what actually didn't happen. In fact, Abraham was so impacted that he renamed the landscape as Yahweh Jireh, Jehovah Jireh. What could have been the backdrop to a horrific murder is renamed, the Lord will see to it, the Lord will provide. I wish that I could always live like that. The Lord will see to it. He'll be okay. I wish I could consistently cast all my anxiety on him because he cares for me, 1 Peter 5:7. I don't know how you feel about that. But thirdly, we've always got to remember with these covenant stories that they're pointing to something else. Set off from Mount Moriah, God said to Abraham, which geographically speaking is Jerusalem. So think temple, think sacrifice. How long did it take them to get there? 3 days. There's so much nudging and winking going on in here, all for our benefit. Abraham says the Lord will provide the sacrifice. And so we reflect on the fact that there was a father who did lay down the life of his only much, much loved son. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. The whole story points towards Jesus, who we'll see in a couple of weeks inaugurates a new and a better covenant. It's all through Jesus, God's ultimate provision for a broken world. Why does the Bible matter? Well, the Bible informs us through its stories, through the letters. Romans 8, we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. A verse like Romans 8:31, just shared, becomes important for us. It was important long before 2020 and 2021, and it will remain important for Christians in the future. There are so many broken elements in our world that need to be made new. But God can be trusted. He is good. He does provide. His mercy endures forever. His covenants in the Old Testament hint at it. And Jesus proves it. So may we, in days where it's hard to guess what the Lord is up to, what he might be teaching us through these events that are unfolding, may we live in step with wherever the Spirit leads us. Life is rarely straightforward, but God is good, and he is working all things together for our good. He does love us. He won't abandon us. Romans chapter 8 finishes like this. Let me share with you. And I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from his love. Death can't and life can't. The angels can't and the demons can't. Our fears for today, our worries about tomorrow, and even the powers of hell can't keep God's love away. Whether we are high above the sky or in the deepest ocean, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus, our Lord. We're going to finish with a song from the worship team. It's a new song called Desert Song. This is my prayer in the desert when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer and my hunger in me. My God is the God who provides, Jehovah Jireh. May we know that as a living experience today and in all the days to come.
Thank you. Okay.